Well, no wonder I know that song. I've been practicing it all week. So with the Lord's help and the Holy Spirit to sing this for me, I'm going to do my best. Last night as I lay sleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. I thought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and see. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And then I thought my dream was changed. The streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery. The morn was cold and chilled as the shadow of a cross arose upon that lonely hill. As a shadow of a cross arose upon that lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how the angels sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. Then once again the scene was changed. New earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. And the gates were open wide, and all who would might enter, and no one was denied. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. It was the new Jerusalem that would not pass away. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing for the night
Amen. Thank you, Vi. Drago said he'll be out next Sunday if there are kids here. So you guys be sure to make sure there are kids here next Sunday. Oh, you're not kids. The scriptures I'll be using this morning, you'll find in the back of your bulletin, other than chapter 22 in the Psalms that I'll be referring to. And so eventually you'll want to turn there. I know it's Palm Sunday, and the Sunday of Christ's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The people were casting branches, palm branches or such, and their cloaks on the ground as he came down the hill toward Jerusalem, and shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And there was such excitement, and it was like the people were crying out, "Oh Lord, our King, I love you, we love you." But the next week, "Crucify him, crucify him." Love is fickle, isn't it? How many people have said, "Oh, I love you," and something goes wrong, and, "Well, you know, I used to love you anyway." Is that love? Think about it. What does real love look like? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to look to your word. And it is your word that your Holy Spirit uses to touch our hearts and lives. You said your word would not return to you void, but would accomplish what you please, and it would fulfill the purpose for which you sent it. Lord, accomplish what you please in our hearts this morning through your word, we pray. We are dependent on you, upon your Holy Spirit, to minister to our hearts. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning, rather than focusing on Palm Sunday itself, it just made me stop and think about love. And no greater love. In John 15:13, when Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, and he's giving them some final instructions before his death on the cross, he made this statement: "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends." And that's what he was about to do. He says, there's no greater love than my love for you. When we look at Calvary, we're looking at the epitome of love. And we're told by John in 1 John that God is love. And if you want to know what love is like, what love is, look to Christ. He first lived that love as he walked among people. And then he died on that cross with the highest expression possible of love. Wow. No greater love. He knew where he was going. He knew he would be on the cross. But he said, "I love you that much." Have you experienced his love? In 1 John 4, 9 and 10, we read, "In this the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world." So not only do we have the love of the Son in his death, we have the love of the Father knowing his son was going to die for a wretched person like me. What? He loved me while I was yet a sinner. He died for us while we were yet sinners because of our sin. What love. And then it goes on. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the propitiation or satisfaction for our sins. He paid the price of my sins. Wow. And then verse 19 says, we love him because he first loved us. When we really come to grips with the love of God for us, it should just draw us into loving him. There's no greater love than what he gave. No one will ever love you more than what he does. Man, you know, I was in a loveless marriage for many years. And 36 years of a loveless marriage. I thought all my life would be in that. My first wife died, and I married Margaret. And Margaret loved me. And man, because of her love and loving me, I wanted to love her. I wanted to give her, in a sense, my all. That's how we respond to real love, isn't it? That we want to give love back. How are we responding to real love? The love of God for us. Man, his love reached its apex when he died on that cross. And he saw you. And he saw me. Even in eternity past, he saw the cross from eternity past that he was going to die on. We're told that in Scripture. His death, in a sense, was anticipated what he was going to face all that time in human terms. Because he loved you, and he loves me. What love? No greater love. In John 1, 1 through 3, we read, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that was made. So the Word was there in the beginning. He already there with God. The Word was God. What are we talking about when we talk about the Word? Well, you go to verse 14 as John continues. And he says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And the very next verse says, John bore witness of him, Jesus. Jesus is not only the man who came to die, he was very God. God the Son, part of the Trinity of Father, Son, and Spirit, a total unity of one, and yet three persons. They all suffered when he died on that cross. But here, God came down, became a man. We're not just talking about another man dying. God came down. God the Son, to die for me and for you. There is no greater love. No greater love. Turn with me to Psalm 22. I'm going to kind of peruse this psalm. I was looking at the various gospels of Christ's death on the cross, And, you know, Matthew tells part of the story. Mark tells the story and includes a few other things, or doesn't include everything Matthew did. Each of the Gospels gives us a broad picture as you put them together. And I think Psalm 22 puts them all together pretty well. In Psalm 22, the prophecy of Christ dying on the cross is laid out. We can see it there, written 1,500 years or more before Christ died. And so, I'll read some and make comments as we go along. But in verse 1, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from me, or from helping me, and from the words of my groaning? Have you ever been there? Where you were going through the stuff and you felt like, God, where are you? Why are you so far from me? Don't you hear my groaning? I've been there. Sometimes we're there. You know, the one who loved you went through that. In his humanity, he felt that distance. Where are you, God? Do you realize what I'm going through? And sometimes we think God's not listening. God's not there. My God, why have you forsaken me? And Christ spoke those words from the cross because he loved you and loved me. He was willing to face that. Verse 2, oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear. And in the night season, I am not silent. We're told in Hebrews that he cried out. And the implication is he cried out often to God, to the Father, about what he was going to go through. And here it tells us he cried in the daytime, he cried at night. At night, we're told in Luke 15:5 or somewhere in there, it's not in your bulletin, but it says he went a little further and fell on his face, and he cried out saying, oh my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And you could almost add those words, because Father, I love these people. No greater love. As you go on down to verse 6, it says, but I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised by the people. Crucify him. Crucify him. Away with him. He was treated like a worm, despised by the people. All those who see me ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake their head, saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delighted in him. And that's what the people spoke from the foot of the cross. The Pharisees and the others who were jealous of his ministry. He trusted in the Lord. Let the Lord do something. And you go on. Verse 9. But you are he who took me out of the womb. You made me trust while on my mother's breasts. I was cast upon you from birth, from my mother's womb. You have been my God. Speaking in his humanity, going back to his incarnation, he had been in constant contact with his Father from the incarnation. God become flesh. Do I understand that? No, but God is God. And nothing's impossible with him. But it's like he's saying, you know, you've been with me, Father, all this time. You've seen me all along this way as I've faced all these things, and now here I am, helpless on this cross. And people, the people I love, the people I'm dying for, ridiculing me. What a God. A God that loves us that much. Verse 12, many bulls have surrounded me. Strong bulls of Bashan have encircled me. They gape at me with their mouths like a raging and roaring lion. In all this time, you come to verse 14, I am poured out like water, and my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. A potsherd was an old piece of pot, something that had broken and it was on the ground facing the heat. And my tongue clings to my jaws. You've brought me to the dust of death. Can you just imagine what he was going through, the joints, what they would feel as you hung there on that cross, nails, the wrist. When they speak of the hands in the Greek, the hand included the wrist, and they would put the nails right in this part of the wrist when they put a person on the cross. If they put it here, it would split out and pull away. So it was put here. So when he talks about putting your finger in my wound in my hand, it's right there. But you ever been where you were thirsty? You know, I hike out in the mountains in the desert in the heat a lot of times. Some people think I'm crazy. They might be right. But anyway, there are times I'm out there and hiking and it's hot and my mouth gets so dry and my tongue kind of clings, but I've got some water in my pack. And I'm not dying on a cross. But he went through that for us. Verse 16, the dogs have surrounded me. The congregation of the wicked has enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They look and stare at me. They divide my garments among them. And for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far from me. O my strength, hasten to help me. Deliver me from the sword. There have been times I've gone through things and it's like, Lord, please deliver me from this. That's nothing compared to this, what he went through. But then you go over to verse 25. And he speaks of the Father as my praise shall be of you in the great assembly. I will pay my vows before those who fear me or fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him will praise the Lord. Let your heart live forever. Really speaking of, he is risen. We can praise him. Praise God, he is risen, just as he said. There is no greater love than that love that he gave us. In loving us, God the Son in his humanity gave his all. Do I truly love him? Am I giving him my all? As I said before, he lived his love when he walked on earth. And he came to that point of the highest expression of his love in dying a terrible death that we might have life. all of this an aspect of his love. But then he calls us to this in Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, Paul says, by the Holy Spirit, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, the cross of God, the Son, that you present your bodies a living, holy, acceptable, living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. He gave his all for me. Am I willing to give my all to him? My all? Lord, here I am. I'm yours. All of me. A living sacrifice. Those are just words in a sense until actions back them up. And so in verse 2, we read there in Romans 12, and do not be conformed to this world, the stuff of this world, but be transformed in the renewing of your mind, and it's renewed by the Holy Spirit through the Word of God, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In other words, to prove what is acceptable, which is, in other words, his will, is to live the truth of his word. We need to be men and women of the word and digging into the truth and then living out the truth of the word. That it's not just words, oh, I give myself to God. The proof's in the pudding. Am I living it? Can people see Christ in my life? Do they see my love for him that then goes out in love for others, in the way I respond to others, the way I treat others? Am I living the truth of this book? There's no greater love than the love that he gave us. No greater love. Are we going to give our love back to him? As it said there in John 4, 19, we love him because he first loved us. Has his love touched your heart? Love him back. Give him your all. Get into the word and let the word of God get into you and start living it. Not picking and choosing, living out the truth of this book, of God's word. What a privilege that is. We are privileged to love the God who made all this universe, our world, and us. And we're privileged to live for him. Wow. Let's pray. Lord, indeed, what a privilege it is. And Lord, sometimes this is just a good reminder to get back on track, living what we've already committed to you. But what a reminder of your love, Calvary love. There is no greater love. And Lord, may we in turn love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then in living it out, love our neighbor as ourself. Help us to live the truth of your word day by day. Lord, we're not perfect. We'll falter along the way. We'll have to come to you at times and say, Lord, I'm sorry, I blew it today. Lord, I shouldn't have said that to those people. I shouldn't have done this. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have had that attitude. Lord, forgive me. But you're there to forgive us. Your love still extends to us. Wow. What a God you are. What a privilege we have of worshiping you. Thank you, Lord. And as we go out from here today, may it be with hearts filled with joy because of the wonder of your love. In your precious name, Jesus, lover of my soul, amen.